Hello, and welcome back to FDTV. As we all know, we're now living in what is an ever-evolving business, social, and political climate, where equality, in all respects, is under the spotlight more than it has ever been before. In fact, 2018 marks the 100th anniversary of women in the UK gaining the right to vote, thanks to the suffragette movement. Having said that, fewer than 10% of the UN member states have female leaders. And according to Korn Ferry's 2017 survey, only 11% of businesses across industries in the US have female CFOs. Furthermore, there are only around 60 women CFOs in the Fortune 500. Therefore, it seems extremely relevant that in this episode of FDTV, we will be looking at female CFOs and female leaders. We travel to the Cotswolds to speak with Catherine Bishop, an Associate Fellow at Said Business School of the University of Oxford, about the most complex and little understood challenges that female leaders have. We also speak with Workday's CFO, EMEA and APJ, Lena Shishkina, about a women's network designed to address imbalance and achieve greater gender parity. But first, we meet with Anna Dupro, Group CFO of Amadeus, at their headquarters in Madrid, where we discuss the key differences between male and female leadership styles and the importance of having gender-balanced teams in order to achieve success.
I think corporations should have diverse teams to have success, because the world is an evolving place. There's a lot of variety of geographies, personalities, traditions, cultures, and the better we understand that, the better for a company would be to fulfill their goals and be successful. So I think diversity is quite important. I think that diversity can be in gender, but can be in age, can be in nationalities, can be in different cultures, and the more you have of everything, the more prepared you will be to face the challenges that every corporation have to tackle with these days.
There are a few differences in female style versus male style, and I would call out three differences that I would see differentiate women at workplace. One is engagement, the second one is empathy, and the third one is multitasking. I don't want to say that these are necessarily the best traits, but I would say engagement and empathy, these traits resonate in the leadership style, they resonate better with people. And I believe in that sense, female leadership style is contributing positively to the company culture. Male are also very focused traditionally, you know, they're very goal orientated, they're pragmatic and more efficient, particularly when you want to get from A to B, whether this is a business situation or whether this is just simply cut the distance. And I believe women can learn a lot from men in that sense. Having said that, I believe that workplace is here for everybody, and everybody's voice needs to be heard. And to be successful in achieving this goal in the company, we need to make sure that the leadership is also equally diverse. And this is not just about men and women.
At Oxford, we have started to talk less about men and women leaders and more about masculine and feminine leadership traits, acknowledging actually that most leaders have a blend of what you might describe as masculine leadership styles and feminine leadership styles. And that diversity is important. It's important for any individual, but it's particularly important for an organisation to be able to have a variety of perspectives, of experiences, of skills, but most of all, to be able to use that diversity respectfully. And that requires an organisation to acknowledge the value of different leadership styles and to encourage a culture of collaboration between people who may come from very different backgrounds. There's quite a lot of research that says diverse leadership teams produce better outcomes on a whole range of scores. And as we look at the complexity of the 21st century, that's got to be the right answer.
What are the most complex and little understood challenges that female leaders face? And how can organisations address these?
The women leaders we see on our executive development programs come from all over the world from a variety of sectors, and they bring with them different kinds of perspectives, but they also bring with them some very similar challenges. And I think I would sum up that as a sense of the dilemmas in one's working life. Dilemmas between work and home, dilemmas between leading the way they want to lead and the way the organisation perhaps expects them to lead. Dilemmas between wanting to be themselves but actually also needing to be courageous and to step forward to lead some really quite difficult challenges. And the development activity that we provide, amongst other things, connects them with other women who are experiencing the same things, even though they may be from a completely different part of the world and a different sector. The kinds of conversations that arise from those meetings, the suggestions, the ideas, the things to try, the things people have tried that didn't work, can be enormously helpful to women leaders.
Workday has a women network called Women at Workday. It is very advanced in the US because of the history of the company and when it started. We have a female network in Ireland for about a year where we have a very advanced R&D community with a lot of women present. And we're just picking up as the company grows in Europe, in UK and France. We came up with three themes, career progression, connections and culture. Career progression is about development, it's about coaching and mentoring. Connections is about network and how effectively women build networks. And culture is about how we create the environment for female talent while connecting very closely to Workday's values and culture. We also welcome men to the female network because we believe workplace is about everybody. It's about everybody contributing and having a role to play.
I think we need equal opportunity. And again, not just for women, but for young people compared to older people, or the opposite, for older people with their experience compared to young and more, if you want, enthusiastic approach to work, and for different cultures to be able to work the different manners we are used to. So it's not the same the way German person would work or a Spanish person will face a problem compared to what a North African would be doing, or in Latin America will be taking different kinds of solutions. So I think that we need to provide opportunity to everybody to do their business and their work and develop it in the way they are best at.
So how important is it for organizations to provide executive education opportunities for their senior executives, especially when developing their female leaders?
Providing executive education for leaders is essential, and I would say this is equally important for men and women. Maybe for women it's more important for the reason just different confidence levels. In my experience, when I took a role in a multinational company, the first thing I did, I got into the executive education, and I really wanted to understand what I didn't know, but also confirm the knowledge that I already have, so that would set me for success. And it was the most difficult time, it was the most hectic time. I had a lot of fires to fight back at work when you start this new big job. But the first time I've done this was really beneficial. So it really set the scene, the foundation for success. I learned the things that I didn't know and built my success on the things that I did know. The other important thing in executive education is it's the network. It's essential for providing the network for the people who are new on the jobs, but also people who have been in the jobs for a while. So I believe it's a very, very important thing to have.
Investment in development for executives is well worth the time and money, because the challenges most organisations face in this part of the 21st century are things we've never seen before. Executive development can give leaders time to think, tools to think differently, and practice in thinking collaboratively with people who have a very different background. Executive development for women can bring particular benefits. A recent Harvard Business Review article noted that there are real improvements in financial outcomes, and what you might call intellectual outcomes for women who attend conferences or development programs. For example, a recent study of about 2,600 women leaders in the United States indicated that for women who had attended some executive development, there was double the likelihood that they would be promoted in the next 12-month period. Perhaps more interestingly, 78% of those who attended a development program reported a visible increase in their own personal optimism. And positivity translates into productivity, which is good for the individual leader, but is also good for the organization and illustrates the kind of benefit that the investment can bring.
So, what will be the biggest challenge for the generation of women approaching senior leadership positions in the next few years?
Like everybody else, you need to cope with the fact that you need to work, live life, and as probably Seneca would say, life is short and you need to be able to do many things at the same time, and it's not always easy. But I think that's for women, and again, for any human being. I don't think coping with everything is kind of easy. You need to do what you're best at. You need to put a lot of effort. There's a Spanish philosopher also, Ortega Gasset, that says you need to have a little bit of luck, but luck should find you working hard. And with that, most likely, you will be able to fulfill. And I always tell everybody, starting with my children and then employees and everybody, which is, and whatever you are, just enjoy what you're doing, because life is short, so you should be enjoying what you're doing. So being obsessed, when I get this question about how do you planify your career, well, I didn't. I just work a lot. I enjoy what I was doing. I try to be as good as I could in everything I do. I took every opportunity I was given, and I tried to learn, and I opened my eyes, I listened, and little by little you progress. And if sometimes you're stuck, enjoy. Then you will have more time, free time to do other things, and maybe cultivating other areas of your life, you can also improve in your work.
Over the last two or three years at Oxford, women participants on our leadership programmes have expressed a surprising and encouraging degree of optimism about leadership in the next decade, talking about an increase in opportunities and an increase in acceptance of a whole range of different leadership styles. They look forward to a generation of women raised by mothers and fathers to lead regardless of their gender.
There are a few challenges for the generation of women behind us and working with us currently. I can name a couple of them. For example, changing paradigms in the workplace. Will the hierarchical careers matter in the future? Will the upward careers really be something that women be going after? What is the definition of success? The other thing on the social front, a couple of things on the social front. One is, what defines success, the male and female success, as I mentioned, but also the retreat. I call it retreat because I've seen some very successful female leaders were thinking, well, it's not any longer important for me to build a career, so I'll retreat to my roots, look after the children, you know, look after the house. It's also interesting dynamics in the male world when they would like to retreat themselves, not necessarily going after the corporate world, doing something more meaningful in life as they believe so. The other thing is, how do you keep up with pace, the pace of time? And also, if you're a family or having kids, how do you actually keep up with your digital natives? So I think there are a few challenges out there that would really change the future of the workplace. And last but not the least is how the jobs are going to be in the future. The current jobs might get obsolete, and the new jobs might be created that we don't know what they are.
As we have heard from all of our interviewees, one of the best ways for an organization to improve and develop their top talent is to invest in it. Whilst this will naturally require investment from a financial as well as time perspective, it will considerably benefit not only the individual, but also, ultimately, the organization itself. No matter which route you choose to go down, be it an executive education course, women's network or other, just remember, it is essential to achieve not just a gender balanced team, but one that is rich in overall diversity in order to achieve true success. Thank you very much for watching, and please don't forget to like and subscribe.